Hachette Audio presents The Terror. Written by Dan Simmons. Read by Simon Vance. Latitude 70 degrees 5 minutes north. Longitude 98 degrees 23 minutes west. October 1847. Captain Crozier comes up on deck to find his ship under attack by celestial ghosts. Above him, above Terror, shimmering folds of light lunge but then quickly withdraw like the colourful arms of aggressive but ultimately uncertain spectres. Ectoplasmic skeletal fingers extend toward the ship, open, prepare to grasp, and pull back. The temperature is minus 50 degrees Fahrenheit and dropping fast. Because of the fog that came through earlier, during the single hour of weak twilight now passing for their day, the foreshortened masts, the three topmasts to gallants, upper rigging and highest spars have been removed and stored to cut down on the danger of falling ice and to reduce the chances of the ship capsizing because of the weight of ice on them, stand now like rudely pruned and topless trees, reflecting the aurora that dances from one dimly seen horizon to the other. As Crozier watches, the jagged ice fields around the ship turn blue, then bleed violet, then glow as green as the hills of his childhood in Northern Ireland. Almost a mile off the starboard bow, the gigantic floating ice mountain that hides Terror's sister ship, Erebus, from view, seems for a brief, false moment to radiate colour from within, glowing from its own cold, internal fires. Pulling up his collar and tilting his head back, out of 40 years' habit of checking the status of masts and rigging, Crozier notices that the stars overhead burn cold and steady. But those near the horizon not only flicker, but shift when stared at, moving in short spurts to the left, then to the right, then jiggling up and down. Crozier has seen this before, in the far south with Ross, as well as in these waters on earlier expeditions. A scientist on that South Polar trip had told Crozier that the perturbation of the stars was probably due to rapidly shifting refraction in the cold air, lying heavy but uneasy over the ice-covered seas and unseen frozen land masses. In other words, over new continents never before seen by the eyes of man. Or at least, Crozier thinks, in this northern Arctic, by the eyes of white men. Crozier and his friend and then commander James Ross had found just such a previously undiscovered continent, Antarctica, less than 5 years earlier. They named the sea, inlets, and landmass after Ross. They named mountains after their sponsors and friends. They named the two volcanoes after their two ships, these same two ships, calling the smoking mountains Erebus and Terror. Crozier was surprised they hadn't named some major piece of geography after the ship's cat. They named nothing after him. There is, on this October winter's dark day evening in 1847, no Arctic or Antarctic continent, island, bay, inlet, range of mountains, ice shelf, volcano, or fucking floeberg, which bears the name of Francis Rawdon Moira Crozier. Crozier doesn't give the slightest goddamn. Even as he thinks this, he realizes that he's a little bit drunk. Well, he thinks, automatically adjusting his balance to the icy deck, now canted 12 degrees to starboard and down 8 degrees by the bow. I've been drunk more often than not now for 3 years, haven't I? Drunk ever since Sophia. But I'm still a better sailor and captain drunk than that poor, unlucky bastard Franklin ever was sober. Or his rosy-cheeked, lisping pet poodle Fitzjames, for that matter. Crozier shakes his head and walks down the icy deck forward to the bow, and toward the only man on watch he can make out in the flickering light from the aurora. It is short, rat-faced Cornelius Hickey, Calker's mate. The men look all the same out here on watch in the dark, since they're all issued the same cold-weather slops, layers of flannel and wool, covered with a heavy waterproof greatcoat, bulbous mittens, their Welsh wigs, heavy watch caps with floppy ears pulled tight, often with long comforters, scarves wrapped around their heads, until only the tips of their frost-bitten noses are visible. But each man layers or wears his cold-weather slops slightly differently, adding a comforter from home, perhaps, and Crozier has learned to tell all 59 of his surviving officers and men apart, even at a distance, outside and in the dark. Hickey is staring fixedly out beyond the icicle-sheathed bowsprit, the foremost 10 feet of which are now embedded in a ridge of sea ice, as HMS Terror's stern has been forced up by the ice pressure and the bow is pushed lower. He starts slightly as Crozier leans close to him at the railing. Men traditionally don't salute during the winter in the ice, but the thick-clad Hickey does that odd little shuffle and shrug and head dip by which the men acknowledge their captain's presence while outside.
"Mr. Hickey? Anything?"
"Nothing since that one shot almost 2 hours ago, sir. Just a while ago I heard, maybe a scream from out beyond the ice mountain. I reported it to Lieutenant Irving, but he said it was probably just the ice acting up."
Crozier had been told about the sound of the shot from the direction of Erebus, but there'd been no repetition of the sound, and he'd sent no messenger to the other ship, nor anyone out on the ice to investigate. To go out on the frozen sea in the dark now with that thing waiting in the jumble of pressure ridges and tall sastrugi was certain death. Messages were passed between the ships now only during those dwindling minutes of half-light around noon. In a few days there would be no real day at all, only Arctic night. 100 days of night.
"Perhaps it was the ice," said Crozier,
wondering why Irving hadn't reported the possible scream.
"The shot as well. Only the ice."
"Yes, Captain. The ice it is, sir."
Neither man believes it. But it's true that the ice pack squeezing ever more tightly against Terror is always rumbling, moaning, cracking, snapping, roaring, or screaming. Crozier turns slowly.
"Is Lady Silence still on deck?"
"Oh yes, Captain. She's almost always up here,"
says Hickey, whispering. Even if Silence could hear them, she couldn't understand their English. But the men believe, more and more every day the thing on the ice stalks them, that the young Eskimo woman is a witch with secret powers.
"She's at the port station, with Lieutenant Irving,"
adds Hickey. Crozier strides up the deck, toward the port lookout post. The appointed port lookout for this watch, Midshipman Tommy Evans — Crozier identifies the youngest man on board by the absurd green stocking cap, obviously made by the boy's mother, that Evans always pulls down over his bulky Welsh wig — has moved 10 paces astern to allow Third Lieutenant Irving and Silence some privacy. This makes Captain Crozier want to kick someone, everyone, in the arse. The Eskimo woman looks like a short, round bear in her furry parka, hood, and pants. But Irving is crowded close to her along the rail, not quite touching, but closer than an officer and gentleman would stand to a lady on a pleasure yacht.
"Lieutenant Irving!"
Crozier didn't mean to put quite so much bark into the greeting, but he is not unhappy when the young man levitates, almost loses his balance, grabs the iced railing with his left hand, and, as he insists on doing despite now knowing the proper protocol of a ship in the ice, salutes with his right hand.
"As you were!"
snaps Crozier.
"Goddamn fool," he mentally adds. "This isn't your watch, Lieutenant."
"Aye, aye, sir. I mean, no, sir. I mean, the captain is correct, sir. I mean..."
Irving clamps his mouth shut again, but the effect is ruined somewhat by the chattering of his teeth.
"Why are you still out here, John?"
"You ordered me to watch over our guest, to look out for..."
"Silence, Captain."
"I didn't mean every minute, Lieutenant. I told you to watch her. Report to me on what she does, to keep her out of mischief and harm's way on the ship, and to see that none of the men do anything to compromise her. Do you think she's in danger of being compromised out here on deck, Lieutenant?"
"No, Captain."
"Do you know how long it takes for exposed flesh to freeze out here, Lieutenant?"
"No, Captain. I mean, yes, Captain. Rather quickly, sir, I think."
"You should know, Lieutenant Irving. You've had frostbite 6 times already, and it's not even officially winter yet."
Lieutenant Irving nods dolefully.
"Go below, John, and see Dr. MacDonald about your face and fingers. I swear to God that if you've gotten seriously frostbitten again, I'll dock you a month's Discovery Service pay and write your mother to boot."
"Yes, Captain. Thank you, sir."
Irving starts to salute again, thinks better of it, and ducks under the canvas toward the main ladderway. Crozier sighs again. He likes John Irving. The lad had volunteered, along with two of his mates from the HMS Excellent, Second Lieutenant Hodgson and First Mate Hornby. Of course, that had been on a warm May day in England in 1845.
"And now the poor young pup is in love with an Eskimo witch," Crozier mutters aloud.
As if understanding his words, Silence turns slowly toward him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.